It was the biggest TV music show of all time, a mainstay of our lives for over 40 years.
Top of the Pops was the most important programme of the week.
The show was watched by tens of millions of people.
It was electric.
But behind the scenes, Top of the Pops was chaotic, crazy, and very nearly calamitous.
There's nobody saying anything, you've got no auto-cue.
The audience was sort of like cannon fodder, really.
We'll uncover shocking stories of drugs.
I must have been high. This is a trip.
Demanding divas.
You're not allowed to go any further right than that. Don't shoot her any further right than that.
Tea time, nudity.
All you can see is 12 nipples dancing.
And technical disasters.
Ring the fire brigade.
But also the show's decline and a tarnished legacy.
So many people were tainted by the stories that emerged once the dam had burst.
Tonight, we're going to reveal the secrets and scandals of the world's longest-running pop programme. It's a Thursday at 7:10 in 1976, and families are gathered around the TV, excited to watch Top of the Pops. But over in West London, something very strange is happening to its presenter, Diddy David Hamilton.
I was actually known as Take One Hamilton because I did most things in one take. And I remember one occasion when I got something terribly wrong and I was introducing Rod Stewart singing The Killing of Georgie. And I introduced it and I said, and now Rod Stewart and The Killing of Georgie fame. So the floor manager went, cut.
Almost, David. It's The Killing of Georgie. Have another go.
So we do it again and I say, and now here's Rod Stewart and The Killing of Georgie fame. He goes, cut.
Come on, Diddy, one more try.
And I'm aware of, you know, people around me in the studio talking and looking at me very strangely, like, is he all right? You know, is there something wrong with him? So anyway, the third time I managed to get it right.
But what on earth had happened to put Diddy Hamilton off his stride? The shocking truth can now be told.
A couple of years later, I met a couple of song pluggers and they said, well, we actually put something in your drink in the canteen. We gave you a Mickey Finn. We did it for a joke. Well, I must have been high, but not in the best way, you know. Far out, man. This is a trip.
David's trip may have been unplanned, but legendary tales of boozing bands, heavy partying, and all sorts of substances have followed Top of the Pops around for years. Music stars taking drink and drugs. Oh, no, that can't possibly be true, can it?
The question of whether it's true about drink and drugs being consumed by bands on Top of the Pops is really like asking, is it true that strawberries were picked in Kent last summer? You know, of course they were.
As Julian Cope, frontman of The Teardrop Explodes, gave this intense, straight-down-the-lens performance in 1981, it's doubtful viewers will have guessed what had fueled it.
You would not have known that. It was word perfect. It is a magnificent performance for somebody who was tripping.
Yes, in his 1994 autobiography, Head On, Cope admitted he took huge hits of LSD before that performance and he was tripping on live TV.
In rock bands, do you really believe they're not having the cheeky line of something? Of course they are. And there was lots and lots and lots of drinking.
But where did they find the time? Well, that wasn't a problem on Top of the Pops.
The Pops were sticklers for having all the artists arrive early. So it was a very, very long day.
The producers would normally ask them to arrive at about 10 in the morning, and they often wouldn't be finished until 11 at night. And that left an awful lot of time for the bands to get up to stuff.
The BBC Club was very popular. In fact, it was referred to as, I'm just nipping up to the fourth floor, because that's where the BBC Club was.
So after the rehearsals, and before the dress run, it was quite usual for the acts to go up to the fourth floor and enjoy a sherbet or two.
It was a very strange environment and always full.
And you'll find quite a few artists a little bit oiled before their performances.
This live 1983 performance of the appropriately named Margarita Time by legendary rockers Status Quo saw guitarist Rick Parfitt perhaps being a little bit, well, too well oiled.
You see him collapse onto the drum kit. And he completely paralytic. It just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
But was there more to it than that? Rick and his partner in crime admitted the full story during a candid TV interview in 2004.
I had had quite a lot to drink, which we always had when we did Top of the Pops in those days.
I had told the drummer that I was going to walk into the kit. And I said, don't tell anybody else, just you and I know about it. And you knew about it anyway, didn't you?
Yeah, I was there when you told Pete.
Well, that's cleared that up then. So it's no wonder they were boozed up if they had a bar in the studio. But getting served wasn't always easy. There was only one way to get in.
This is my BBC club card. These were literally gold dust. If you had one of these, you could get into the BBC bar.
If you didn't have a card and we weren't a staff, a card-carrying staff member, we weren't allowed in. So you had all these artists like Slade and Mudd and David Bowie all trying to get in, and there's this bloke in a commissionaire's outfit saying, well, no, sorry, if you're not with a member, you can't come in. And so we all used to think up these ruses of how to get in.
But if you could make it into the bar, it might just be the setting for a secret rock and roll romance.
I remember once Rod Stewart was there, and he sent somebody over to ask if I wanted to go out with him one evening. And of course I said yes, because I'd always fancied him.
But some acts didn't need to visit the bar. They just brought their own supplies.
The Wurzels were a novelty 70s band from Somerset. And they came down to Top of the Pops. They had a big hit with I Am a Cider Drinker. And they brought with them 5 gallons of hardcore Somerset Scrumpy for the dressing room. And on the first performance, a few of the production women came in to wish them luck and tell them what was happening, and said, what, do you want some scrumpy? And they're giving these women these cups of industrial strength scrumpy. And the women said, oh, this is nice. Can I have another one, please? And they confessed. One of them said she hadn't made it home that night because she'd fallen asleep on the train, woke up at the end of the line, had to get a hotel. Another one had spent the night in police cells, hadn't been found by the police, passed out in a hedge, covered in sick. Because you don't mess with scrumpy.
So, sozzled on scrumpy or not, all the huge stars of the day were there, and luckily, Television Centre was big enough to accommodate them. So big that when the Jacksons were due to appear on the show in 1977, they almost mislaid one member of the family.
TV Centre was like a donut. It was a circle, and in the basement, it was the same thing. You just go round, and all the doors are exactly the same. And I remember the guy saying, OK, we're going up now, we're going on into the studio. Let's get ready. And as we're walking through, I'm saying, where's Michael? And Tito said, I don't know, Judd. I think he went out for a walk. And the next thing is, I can hear in the distance, Judd, I'm lost. Judd, where are you? Michael, I'm here. Where?
Yes, Television Centre was a bit of a maze, but it did have its uses.
I remember playing football with Slade in the circle of the corridor of the dressing rooms, kicking a ball about with them before we all went on.
Acts wandering around, football in the corridors, sounds like chaos backstage. And even when the show moved to Elstree Studios, it was hard to keep track of the acts. Half of them were trying to secretly sneak into Albert Square.
You know what they love to do more than anything? They wanted to go and tour, have a look around EastEnders.
Bands are coming through, and EastEnders being an institution as well, it's like, let's go and visit the EastEnders set. They've actually had the set alarmed and commissioners patrolling round. And we'd often get in the gallery, you know, that the alarm's gone off at the EastEnders set. And I think there's been a few bands that have sort of legged it over and have set the alarms off, and they had to be escorted off by a commissionaire.
Well, Robbie Williams probably spent more time in the EastEnders set than he did on Top of the Pops. It was a running joke. When is Robbie going to be, you know, in the Queen Vic? Literally, if you couldn't find an artist, you knew they were on the EastEnders set.
Coming up, we reveal how these furry fellows formed a band in 48 hours.
I was ringing up friends of mine who I knew might be good wombles.
And the secret to handling a true diva.
Shania Twain does not do doors.
It's the year 2000, a new millennium. After 4 decades, Top of the Pops is still number one and still attracting the biggest names in music. At Elstree Studios, the Queen of Pop, Madonna, has arrived to record 6 performances for the show in just one day. Madge rolled back the years as she gave this energetic performance of her number one smash. Pops managed to convince the Queen of Pop herself to record 6 back-to-back songs.
Top of the Pops was the most important programme of the week. So important that we had written in our contract that whatever else we were doing, we could pull out at the last minute if we were off the Top of the Pops.
The show was watched by, you know, tens of millions of people. So therefore, your exposure was huge.
And they knew that being on Top of the Pops would sell a hell of a lot of records.
You do Top of the Pops, you sell an extra 100,000 CDs. Yeah, and then money meant money. Not like now with streaming.
So a show that massive must have run on military precision, with everyone knowing exactly what they were meant to be doing, right? Not a bit of it. Off-screen, ruthless manoeuvrings, blatant lies, and sheer chaos often reigned. A quick change into a sexy cowgirl outfit and some artfully placed hay bales, and Madge was ready for the next of her 6 memorable performances. But what viewers didn't know was that behind the scenes, someone was in serious trouble in Madonna's dressing room.
She'd come through to the studio and she'd be rehearsing all her tracks. Then often after the rehearsals, we'd just show all the costumes to camera to make sure that lighting happy, etc. I always remember going up to her and just saying, oh, you know, wear your outfits. And there was then just this kind of Chinese whispers that went down the line, literally to her stylist at the end, who'd left all of her outfits at the hotel room. You've come all the way from America. The only thing you had to do was bring the outfits from the hotel to the studio. And you've kind of failed.
We can live with the disorganisation, but what we won't stand for is the outright lying involved in making this show. In 1981, when the Jam scored their first UK number one with Going Underground, they faked an illness to get out of their American tour so they could fly home and appear on the show. And another groundbreaking act also got in on the lies.
Underground, overground, wobbling free.
Yes, when these unlikely stars got the chance to make their first Pops appearance, it might not have changed music history, but it was certainly a memorable moment. But we can now expose the secret efforts to bring the Wombles together when Top of the Pops came calling, and the story that was, fabricated.
I was the lead singer, and my mum made my Orinoco outfit. She made me this wonderful Womble costume. Well, Top of the Pops would like to know, is there more than one Womble? Is there a band? Because if there is, you're on Thursday. This was Tuesday. So I said, well, yes, there is a band.
Except there wasn't. It was a barefaced fib. But the chance to be on the most important music show in Britain couldn't be missed. Drastic action was needed to form the ultimate manufactured band.
So I rang my mum and I said, Mum, I suppose you couldn't make 3 more Womble costumes, could you, by Thursday? And we all converged on my mum and dad's house in Bracknell. My 2 brothers, my sister, me, and my mum and dad. And we spent the time between Tuesday evening and Thursday making another 3 Womble costumes. And in the meantime, I was ringing up friends of mine who I knew might be good Wombles.
People don't notice us, they never see.
I said, but just behave like a rock band would. Don't try and be silly. Just be really heavy and make it look as if you mean it. It looks even funnier than if you're trying to sort of do silly things to make people laugh.
But it wasn't just fibbing about being a band and dressing up as recycling rodents that got you on the Pops. We can now reveal a hidden world of skullduggery. Because behind every artist was a dedicated army working furiously in secret to secure them that coveted gig.
In the industry, we were all known as pluggers. It was one of the best gigs you could get because you got this gold American Express card and you could go mad with it. I thought nothing about hiring a helicopter for Run DMC.
Part of my job was to take the chart rundown with the producer's assistant, the production assistant.
And we would be waiting outside the office whilst they were compiling and working out what's up, what's down.
The only way you can get your act on the show was for the act to be going up. That was the rule.
What we do then is we'd all walk in at a given time, and then the producer, director at the time, would, discuss who's available, who's not.
So they would be grabbing our phones off our desks to try and get hold of, to see whether they're available.
It's like Liverpool scoring a goal. You know, if you go, are they available, Judd? Yes. Whoa. Out of go, zoom.
This was all very well, but it got out of hand. Plugs were doing various nefarious things to get into the BBC earlier and earlier and earlier.
To try and get artists on Top of the Pops, you did have to think out of the box.
And we can now expose the extraordinary lengths some pluggers went to in order to grab that prized Pops slot.
There was a band called the Cane Gang, closest thing to heaven. I and a chap called Ollie Smallman decided we needed to get in to see the producer very early, before even the chart had been done. So we decided to sleep in the BBC office overnight. So Ollie and I guised to be engineers, and we were going in. There was a big meeting at Top of the Pops office. I went up to the doorman at the gate saying, we're maintenance, we've come to do, there's a big meeting, we need to get the heating sorted out. And we got away with it. We went through reception, up to the office, got the key from reception, and I put a tent up, and we slept all night. Anyway, it really worked. We got the old clear. We got the go-ahead, and the band were over the moon.
With all this chaos backstage, it needed some creative thinking to keep everyone in line. And one presenter had a secret strategy for dealing with the talent.
Back in the day at Our Street, there was Woolworths next door, all right? And I would go, just before we do the dress rehearsals in the afternoon, I would go to Woolworths and get the biggest bag of pick and mix you've ever seen. And that pick and mix was a leveller, because everybody that came into the studio, I'd always get the bag of pick and mix out. Do you want a pick and mix? I've got Paul McCartney one side, Linda McCartney the other side, and we're going through pick and mix. What you like? I used to use that as a way of maybe just, not just breaking the ice, but getting the conversation going.
Pick and mix? What else was on the menu?
I remember the first time Jamiroquai was on Top of the Pops. OK? He sat there. His mum has given him a packed lunch.
Oh, bless. Sweets and now packed lunches, it's giving me flashbacks to school. And if the bands were the unruly pupils, they needed a scary headmaster to keep them in line. And in the 70s and 80s, they didn't come more feared than Michael Hurl.
Michael Hurl was one of the scariest men in television. A very powerful director, producer.
Top of the Pops probably did need a strong producer figure most weeks, because bands are pretty irreverent, they're pretty chaotic.
I do remember one time, Thin Lizzy had turned up, but when we tried to rehearse with them, they were chatting and laughing and they just wouldn't. Well, Michael Hurl was in the gallery and he was getting quite annoyed. It was wasting a lot of studio time. And he said, tell them they've got one more go. But we counted them in, 5, 4. And they just stood there chatting. And he said, right, that's it. They're off. And they just couldn't believe that they were being thrown off.
Now, Michael was famous for banning people. He banned Frankie Goes to Hollywood. And they were big, but they didn't appear because Michael banned them for at least a year.
And they weren't the only ones.
Madness never used to take the show terribly seriously. And the saxophonist, Lee Thompson, would just chew gum while he was supposedly playing his, miming his saxophone. She'd be chewing away. And one week, Michael Hurl came flying down from the gantry to say, you're a disgrace to the BBC and to yourself. And Stokes said, I thought he was going to add to the Queen.
Michael Hurl had banned them so many times. I think they hold the record of being banned from Top of the Pops than any other band.
But when it came to anarchy, how on earth did Top of the Pops cope when the punks came to town in the 1970s?
Obviously, punks' whole thing was being anti-establishment, revolutionary, and you couldn't have a much more establishment show than Top of the Pops. Top of the Pops knew that punk was happening. It was the dominant music, and they couldn't be not covering it. They're a bit frightened about it. The Damned and the Strangs and quite a few bands said they weren't allowed in the BBC canteen or the BBC bar because the producers were so wary of them, they thought they were going to kind of smash the place up.
But did they? Well, not so much, as it turns out.
The Stranglers one week, before they went to Top of the Pops, the NME wrote a little piece about them in their gossip column. It said, the Stranglers are going to go on Top of the Pops this week. They're bound to smash the place up. So when the band arrived, what they did was they asked for brooms, brushes and mops, and they spent the day cleaning the dressing room.
While managing the punks may have been surprisingly easy, other stars were far more demanding.
We occasionally had one or two divas turn up on Top of the Pops.
Shania Twain was really funny. I knocked on her door and she came from the dressing room door through into the studio. And it was just this hilarious kind of just conga of entourage trying to make sure that whenever Shania got to a door, she didn't have to open it herself, because Shania Twain does not do doors.
Janet Jackson went on the show and famously asked, could her dressing room please be made into an Arabian tent with muslin on the walls and a treasure chest. The treasure chest was apparently a deal breaker. She had to have that.
Mariah Carey always arrived with an entourage, and there would be an American director of photography in the gallery talking to the cameras and say, Crane, go right, stop. You're not allowed to go any further right than that. Don't shoot her any further right from that.
Mariah might have famously insisted on only being photographed on her best side, but these instructions didn't go down well with the put-upon crew.
And then on the night, you'd make sure you went another 4 or 5 foot, just on purpose.
Any cheeky camera work certainly didn't seem to affect this soulful performance from 1991. Come on, lads, back a bit, please. Coming up, the scandalous truth behind the backing tracks is finally told.
And as soon as he's walked out the door, put that in the bin.
And the Who won't get fooled again.
They were absolutely furious.
It's 1964, Top of the Pops has launched, bringing the hottest music acts into our homes every week. But shock horror, turns out they're not actually singing.
From the start, there was no attempt to make it look like it was a live performance. It was meant to be like a disco, but with live bands. It was this strange artifice.
This sedate 1964 performance shows the Hollies clearly miming to their latest hit, as the BBC wanted the music on the show to sound exactly like the records the public were buying. Yes, with a limited budget on the earliest shows, there were no facilities for the bands to perform live, and the Pops employed someone to literally put the records on a turntable while the bands mimed to them. Disc spinner Samantha Just became as famous as the bands and even married Mickey Dolenz from the Monkees. But from then on, how music was performed on Top of the Pops was subject to constantly changing, often confusing rules, mainly due to the Musicians' Union.
It's kind of hard to believe now, but in the 60s, trade unions were ferociously powerful on Top of the Pops as much as anywhere else. And the Musicians' Union, which was a very powerful body, didn't like the fact that bands were miming to records, because that meant nobody was playing live on the show, nobody was getting paid.
The Musicians' Union at the time said that we couldn't use the backing tracks from the record company. We had to make new backing tracks. So during the week, a session was booked outside, and musicians would record a music-only backing track.
Yes, in the first major rule change, bands now had to re-record their own track as a new version, especially for Top of the Pops. This backing track rule led to scandals galore. Open up your eyes, then you realize, here I stand with my everlasting love. In 1968, Love Affair reached the top with this number one smash. But during an interview, the band admitted that they hadn't actually played on the track, using session musicians instead. There was outrage in the press, and it meant the Pops backing track recordings would now be strictly observed to check it was the bands themselves performing at all times.
Thereafter, somebody from Top of the Pops would have to go to a recording to make sure it was the band actually playing on the instruments. Once you'd got your recorded tape of the band and you knew it was them playing the instruments, you had to come back in a cab, because if you put the tape down on the floor and you're in the tube and you were over the motor, there was a strong chance your tape could get wiped.
But these infamous rock stars had their own ideas when it came to backing tracks, and it led to mayhem.
The Who decided that they wanted to use a piece of music that they'd actually recorded as a backing track to enhance the song, and they were going to sing over it, and the BBC wouldn't allow them to do it. They were absolutely furious. And suddenly Pete Townsend got really angry and he picked up a mic and he took the whole mic and he swung it round his head in the middle of the studio and the studio completely scattered.
Wasn't mic swinging Roger's thing? Anyway, no wonder the artists were angry. The backing track demands were, well, scandalous.
So you'd go into a studio and you'd book it for 3 hours. Something that took 3 weeks to record originally, you're expected to reproduce, recreate in 3 hours.
It's Mission Impossible. ABBA, a great example. You know, Benny and Bjorn were sticklers for production. They're perfectionists. No way could we do this in 3 hours. But we had to go through the motions.
And there was a representative from the union and he would turn up. And then he would sit there for a few hours and he would go, OK, right, I've heard enough. I'll see you in the studio.
What happened next with these backing track tapes will shock you to the core.
So what bands basically did was they cheated. They would take the original tape into the studio with them.
And as soon as he's walked out the door, put that in the bin and we'd go to the BBC with the original track. And I'm sure he must have known.
As usual, it was the Wombles throwing a massive rock and roll-shaped spanner in the works.
I was in the studio with Steel Eye Span, this big band who just had the hit with All Around My Hat. And we were going for our second album, and I'm producing and they're playing. And we get the call saying the Womble's going to be on in 2 days' time with Super Womble. It's just gone in the charts. Great news, except I'm working in the studio with a famous rock band. I can't do a backing track. How can I do a backing track? They said, well, you've got to do a backing track because you won't be on Top of the Pops otherwise.
And we can now expose the shocking secret favour Mike asked of Steel Eye Span.
Look, guys, I don't suppose we could just not do your song for a minute, but do a quick version of Super Womble, just the backing track. Would you mind? And they went, no, of course we'd love it.
But little did Steel Eye know what they were letting themselves in for, because pretending you're a Womble comes at a price, you know.
Don Smith walks in, who's the head of the Musicians' Union, and said to them, so, what are your names? And they said, why do you not want to know our names? He said, well, because the same people have got to be in the costumes tomorrow as played the backing track. Which was a new one on me, but he said it was true. So they gave the names, and afterwards I was sort of going, Mike, what have you got us into? So I said, guys, I don't suppose you'd play like Be the Wombles tomorrow or On Top of the Pops with you. And they said, you know what? We'd love it. We would love it to be the Wombles.
Super Womble, Super Womble, Super Womble, Womble.
It's hard to believe that such acclaimed British folk rockers were beneath all that fur in 1975, but they're obviously having a ball.
Recorded the show and back into the limo and off. So nobody ever knew.
But pretending to sing, whether you were dressed as a furry eco-warrior or not, wasn't for everyone.
I know some people didn't like miming.
Famously in the 70s, The Clash wouldn't go on Top of the Pops at all because they thought it was phony and not punk to be miming.
And at one time, there was a Top of the Pops orchestra as well.
Yep, here comes another rule change as the special orchestra was introduced.
Artists who didn't play with a backing band were made to sing with the Top of the Pops orchestra, which a lot of them didn't like to do at all.
Johnny Pearson was the conductor and the artists would sing live to the orchestra.
The Pops orchestra were in full swing during this 1979 performance, but it's a clearly uneasy mix as they valiantly try to recreate the sound of a disco classic.
These were the best session musicians in the country, but the sound just wasn't right.
And they had this regime where they had tea breaks at certain times of the day. And Noddy Holder has described being on Top of the Pops and seeing a top American singer like Roberta Flack was halfway through her song, and the orchestra would suddenly stop. And they'd all put down their trombones and their trumpets and head off to the canteen because it was 3:30 and it was tea break.
But as the show moved into the 80s, change was afoot.
When Michael Hurl took over on the Pops, we still had the live orchestra in the studio, and Michael just thought this was not working with the type of groups that were coming out. So Michael wanted to change this. Unfortunately, the Musicians' Union had their own ideas and said, no, you can't. So there was a big row.
Behind the scenes, the BBC had secret plans to resolve this, but it would lead to a very public scandal.
Then in 1980, the BBC announced a plan to rationalise its staff musicians and to close five of its staff orchestras. And the Musicians' Union brought the musicians out on strike, which meant there were no music programmes on the BBC.
No episodes of Top of the Pops were shown throughout June and July 1980. But when the strike finally ended, it proved a permanent goodbye for the show's in-house orchestra. So get ready for another rule change. Now acts were free to perform their music as they wanted, miming to a backing track or singing live. But it wasn't always a good idea. Against the neon backdrop of the revamped set, New Order's attempt in 1983 to recreate their club classic, Blue Monday, proved to be a magnificent folly.
I see a ship in the harbour. I can and shall obey.
It was really embarrassing when, if anyone done anything live, you know, the vocals would be all over the place.
In a 2006 interview, New Order member Stephen Morris described how everything went wrong. It sounded awful, and how it was the only time in the show's history that a band appeared and the singer went down the following week.
And the other issue with live performance is mixing, because the BBC had, you know, union men there, and nobody was allowed to touch the BBC mixing desk, and there'd be rows galore if you were doing a live performance.
The union hated the whole playing live thing, and in fact, there's a lot of resistance towards New Order doing Blue Monday live. But being bloody-minded manks, they said, no, we're doing it, or we're not going on. And when they finally did it, they said the BBC engineers and union guys spent an age going around putting BBC-approved stickers on their plugs of all the equipment, just to make sure that they were still in charge of things.
But this act very much wished they had insisted on playing for real. When they were involved in one of the biggest musical mishaps in Top of the Pops history, broadcast live to millions. Folk rock band All About Eve were supposed to be performing their latest single, but it looked very much like someone had forgotten to tell them. Cue major embarrassment.
Sea calls to me.
And we can now divulge just what had gone wrong.
The track that was being played from the gallery was going out to air. But unfortunately, the speakers that were giving them the sound had lost power just as the number started. So they sat there in absolute silence while their track was going out on air.
We're just very bemused, I think, as audience members. We were just sort of like looking around thinking, you know, what's going on? I'm sure, well, I know there was a lot of panic going on in the gallery, etc.
It was a live show, that anything that goes wrong goes out on air. There's no turning back.
In the 90s, Britannia was cool, but for Britpop legends Oasis, miming was not cool, and they made their feelings very clear in one notorious appearance. Noel mimed Liam's vocals and Liam mimed Noel's guitar part in perhaps the most unconvincing performance of all time. But it turns out that authentic rock and roll legends Oasis had a bit of history when it came to embarrassing miming incidents, sometimes entirely self-inflicted. They were mad for it.
There was one time when we had Boyzone and Oasis on the actual same show, and the rules were at that time, if possible, you needed to sing live. Certainly, I think it was live vocals to backing track. And then after the sort of supper break, Noel came to the series producer and I and said, I think it's probably better that Oasis mimed. Because if the professional, apparently Liam had been enjoying the bar. So we took the decision to mime. And then Boyzone found out, and Ronan, who was a fan of Oasis, was so chuffed that he sang live and Oasis didn't. He was like, Boyzone sang live. Hit me.
But what you're about to see may be the most offensive case of miming in Top of the Pops history. In 1979, Ian Dury and the Blockheads performed their new single. But hang on, there's something not quite right with the drummer. This is drummer Charlie Charles. This is a white man in black makeup and an afro wig. With Charlie Charles nowhere to be found before the show, Ian Dury's minder was drafted in at the very last minute, unbelievably with makeup and all. But this wouldn't be the first case of some seriously outdated decision-making.
There were times when Top of the Pops just got it completely and totally wrong in a way that you can't even imagine happening in the 21st century. In 1974, Robert Wyatt went on to sing a cover of The Monkees' I'm a Believer. Robert was in a wheelchair.
Viewers watching Robert Wyatt's cover of a Monkees classic in 1974 would have little suspected the outrage it had caused behind the scenes.
And the producer said to him, I'm sorry, but you can't sit in that. Can you please sit in this? And I had quite a flimsy-looking raffia chair they wanted him to sit in. And he said, I'm sorry, but I can't. I'm going to sing in this. And the producer said, you can't sing in that. This is a family show.
In a 2017 interview, Robert disclosed that Top of the Pops bosses had been embarrassed by the fact that he was a wheelchair user and had demanded he sit in a wicker chair instead. When he quite rightly refused, it's clear from the footage that the show tried to frame out the wheelchair altogether. He was also told he'd never work on the programme again and never did. Coming up, pop video controversy.
We went back to the hotel and had to await until we got yes or no from Michael Jackson.
And Top of the Pops goes X-rated.
All the men wanted to stay in the studio to watch the girls' boobs.
It's 1968, the era of free love. A sexual revolution is underway. And Top of the Pops viewers are about to catch a tantalising first glimpse of the iconic dance troupe Pan's People. The earliest performances have been erased from history, but this alluringly risque number is just one of many, which became a staple of the show. But what were Pan's People there for? Well, Top of the Pops may have been the biggest music show in the world, but sometimes the most famous stars simply weren't available, and early ideas to fill in for absent artists fell rather flat.
When Elvis was number one, with Crying in the Chapel, they had a video of a church in Manchester, different angles while the song was being played.
Boring! So it was time to call in the dancers. The first troupe to appear were the Go-Jos in 1964. But it was Pan's People who'd leave the largest impression, as their name would secretly tease.
Pan is the god of dance, of course, isn't he? And debauchery and everything else. We were sexy, but much more sort of tongue-in-cheek sexuality. The men loved it.
Pan's People were very attractive women. They wore very skimpy outfits, and they're on mainstream TV at 7. So obviously they're going to get quite a large, quite enthusiastic male following.
It was always viewed as, oh, this one's for the dads. yes. I think all the dads had their favourite Pan's person. And it was Flick Colby was the choreographer. And she would work out a routine illustrating, sometimes quite literally, the song in question.
Like in this dazzling performance of the Four Seasons 1976 hit Silver Star, with the troupe covered in, you guessed it, silver stars. And not much else.
It was all about running your hands down your legs and opening your legs. It was all very suggestive. And that was how the dance routines were with those girls. When you look back, it's so dated, but it suited the era.
And the raunchy routines went hand in hand with some outrageous costumes, particularly in a Pan's People special, filmed after a show in 1974 with outfits so revealing that lusty-eyed Top of the Pops crew members were even ordered to leave the studio.
We had scandalous costumes. We did one number in the studio, and the studio was absolutely packed. And the director said, right, anybody who isn't actually immediately sort of in with this, please, can you leave? And the reason that was is because we had these costumes, we had these lovely skirts, but our tops were completely see-through. And in this wonderful shot, where the cameraman is panning across us and all you can see is 12 nipples dancing. All the men wanted to stay in the studio to watch the girls' boobs.
Oof, it was a bit much for tea time viewing, wasn't it? One woman in particular took notice of the increasingly risque outfits and was on a mission to clean up the BBC of its so-called utter filth.
Mary Whitehouse was a woman who campaigned
you know, to keep the sort of parameters of the BBC, in, you know, clean and righteous. And the one thing she complained all the time about was Pan's people, because she didn't like our costumes. And we had a pair of white trousers on. She complained because our trousers were see-through.
All this negative attention from someone once dubbed the most dangerous woman in Britain must have put the group's future in jeopardy, surely.
What she didn't understand was that by complaining about what we were wearing, it made us even more infamous, even more famous. So we loved it when she complained.
While Mary Whitehouse's complaints fell on deaf ears with BBC bosses, by 1976, it was decided that Pan's people would be phased out anyway and replaced with the much less naked Ruby Flipper. A change from the all-female lineup, which was sure to raise a few eyebrows.
When Pan's people were felt as if they'd run their course, Top of the Pops introduced a new dance team of Ruby Flipper, which was mixed gender, which was a big break for Top of the Pops and kind of undermined one of the appeals of this as a family show, that Dad didn't have the young ladies dancing in very short miniskirts anymore.
But the new dance group was short-lived, with producers claiming that they were unpopular with audiences. However, there's a shocking secret behind Ruby Flipper's early demise.
Pan's people were all women. Ruby Flipper was mixed sex and mixed race, which in 1975 was tremendously controversial.
Top of the Pops choreographer, Flick Colby, later revealed a shocking conversation she'd had with Bill Cotton, head of light entertainment at the BBC, saying, "Bill Cotton called me in and said the British public didn't want to see black men dancing with white women. I argued, but he told me to form another all-girl group or I was out."
And she protested hugely about this, as you would, but it was basically told, well, this is what we're doing, you can do it or you're off the show.
Just 5 months after their debut, Ruby Flipper were unceremoniously dumped from the programme and replaced by an all-girl group, with viewers even choosing the name.
Well, after Ruby Flipper had finished, the BBC, Top of the Pops, reintroduced an all-girl group and they, in fact, invited the viewers to choose, to name the new group. Think of a name, they had a competition.
And what did the people of our fair nation decide? Eggs and Elko. What kind of a name is that?
And the winner they came up with was Legs and Co.
Ah, cheers, Ian. Well, the public had certainly spoken.
It's amazing some of the archaic thinking now. When you look back, you didn't realise at the time just how old-fashioned that thinking was. Yeah. Some of these things you forget as time goes by.
For 19 years, Top of the Pops relied on dancers to plug the gap for bands that couldn't appear. But by 1983, they were no more, because the music video had well and truly arrived.
At this point, of course, early 80s, was the rise of MTV and the rise of videos, and suddenly record companies were getting artists to spend hundreds of thousands of pounds on making beautiful, elaborate, spectacular videos, which they'd give to Top of the Pops to show for nothing.
But while Pops producers were in full control of the dancers, music videos would bring a whole new set of problems.
If they thought too much flesh was on display or the dancing was getting too raunchy, they could stop that. The problem they always had with pop video is that it was external material.
A new wave of naughty videos tested the limits of what could be shown on Anti-Beeb. Like this video for Duran Duran's 1981 hit Girls on Film. Good grief. It was deemed so filthy, it was banned by the BBC. Girls on film. Girls on film. A move which would be a win for the newly launched and much more liberal MTV.
I mean, one of the clever things about MTV was that if Top of the Pops banned a music video, you went to MTV to see it.
In a bid to win back viewers from the ever-growing MTV, BBC bosses began to secure worldwide video exclusives, and one from Michael Jackson would prove to be the most controversial of all.
There was a period on Top of the Pops in the early 90s where we would agree to play exclusive videos, and I was offered at one stage Michael Jackson's new video, Black or White, and I agreed to it, naturally.
But what Stanley hadn't banked on was the video for Jacko's 1991 hit being a whopping 11 minutes long, with scenes that would be much too shocking to show on the BBC.
It was very long. Bearing in mind, we only used to play 3 minutes. There was one section in it which I couldn't really show in this country, and I told them this, and they said, well, we'll have to go back and check it with Michael. We had to wait until we got yes or no from Michael Jackson, and it was agreed that we could make the edit.
What a relief. So with the video being BBC and MJ approved, it was ready for its worldwide debut. But during that week's dress rehearsal, what was actually in the 11-minute video remained a complete mystery to those in the studio.
When you do a dress rehearsal, it's as the proper thing. So literally, we're told, for 11 minutes, we're going to look at nothing. 11 minutes is a long time. Just try counting for a minute. 11 minutes.
And you can clearly see the excitement on the presenters' faces as the moment finally arrives.
Exclusive to Top of the Pops, it hasn't been shown anywhere. Here comes the premiere of Michael Jackson's Black or White.
But as the video went out on television screens across the country, complaints began to flood in from viewers who slammed the video as sick, criticising the sexually suggestive images of Jacko repeatedly grabbing his crotch. But with all these complaints, just how shocking was the part that they didn't get to see?
It was actually Michael Jackson standing on a car, smashing the car to pieces with a hammer.
Yes, this section of a vandalising Jacko gyrating, oh, and zipping up his flies, was removed from the final 4.5 minutes of the video, none of which even contained any music at all.
I mean, these days you'd accept it, but, 30 years ago, not the right thing to show.
Those 11 minutes for me, then, it wasn't long enough. Now, I'm thinking, could have done everything inside 3 minutes.
If acts during the 90s weren't making inappropriate music videos, they were singing inappropriate songs, sending the complaints line red hot.
Normally, when you'd come in and you'd look at the answer machine the day after the show had been up, there might be a complaint about the odd thing, or they didn't like the colour of something, or they felt an outfit might be a bit too outrageous, or, you know, there'd be some weird thing.
And after American R&B group Colour Me Bad performed their new single in 1991, complaints about the song's particularly direct lyrics began to flood in.
Their song was I Wanna Sex You Up. You know, I wanna sex you up. And basically, there'd been complaint after complaint after complaint on there about the lyrics and about the song. And in fact, so much so, the actual answer machine, the tape had run out. And there was one woman I particularly remember who was a mum who was watching it with her daughter who said, this is absolutely disgusting that my daughter is watching these men wanting to sex her up. And, you know, this is not allowed. And it just went on and the song continued and they kept singing it. You just sort of can't help thinking, well, why didn't this woman just sort of turn the television over or at least turn it off so her daughter wasn't watching it? But she continued to watch it right till the end of the song.
Coming up, we reveal the truth behind the show's glamorous on-screen image.
What was amazing about it was how unsophisticated it was.
And just how tough it was to be a Pops presenter.
It is like trying to land a plane at, say, Heathrow with no air traffic control.
It's October 1986. Margaret Thatcher opens the last stretch of the M25 motorway and Top Gun is flying high at the box office. But at the top of the Pop Studio at Television Centre, it looks like there's been some sort of emergency. Cyndi Lauper there, bravely battling on through what looks like an extreme weather event.
Dry ice was the bane of all our lives on Top of the Pops. I do remember nights when you couldn't see anything. It was just engulfing the entire studio.
There was a guy called Roger the Iceman. He did all the kind of like smoke and mist on stage effects. Roger is proper old school. You want ice or you don't want ice? I get paid the same.
Artists would disappear sort of quite frequently in Roger's dry ice. We would always laugh when you could see it coming up, it's coming up, it's coming up. Oh, they've disappeared.
With Top of the Pops having to accommodate hundreds of acts year on year, the beleaguered backstage crew had a complicated and sometimes dangerous job on their hands, including This extraordinary 1968 performance by the original Hellraisers, The Crazy World of Arthur Brown, complete with Arthur's scandalous flaming headwear, looked like a health and safety nightmare. But just how dangerous was it?
We had performed the act and honed it for a couple of years with the fire helmet and a lot of accidents and scorched ceilings and burnt suits. We had a fire blanket. If I was on fire, I could get rolled in it. A fire bucket, and then we also had the fire extinguishers. The BBC technicians really enjoyed it. So they put everything into it they could to make it into a real piece of drama.
But as the show evolved from black and white to colour, this just meant more problems of a fiery nature.
Not only have we got colour cameras on the floor, but the very first colour monitors were put into the viewing rooms. But the problem with the very first colour monitors is they'd start to smoke and then burst into flames. So I ran out the door and I bumped straight into one of the BBC firemen. And I said, "It's about to catch fire." And he said, "Look at my badge on my shoulder, Sonny." I said, "Yes." He said, "What does it say?" I said, "Fire prevention officer." He says, "If it started, it's nothing to do with me. Ring the fire brigade."
And in the 1991 Christmas special, it was a national treasure who almost went up in flames.
Obviously, Christmas time lends itself to candles. So we had this set where there was a fireplace with Christmas cards in the background, and there was the two candelabra. And then we get to the dress rehearsal, and Cliff Richard, he started sort of as he was singing to do his sort of movement, which was kind of getting quite energetic. And the floor manager and I looked at each other and sort of thought, those cards are going to go up in flame at any point now.
So Cliff was moved away from the fiery hazard, but some sneaky camera trickery made it look like he was still just as close.
And it looks like he's nearer than he actually is. He was a bit more further downstage. So he narrowly avoided setting Cliff Richard on fire.
But battling with the elements behind the scenes was just part of the struggle to get a demanding, fast-paced programme on air every week. Top of the Pops might have been the biggest pop show in the world, but it certainly wasn't as polished as you might think.
I grew up watching Top of the Pops as a kid, and it always seemed such a slick show every week with all the groups on. I've got to say, it was a bit of an eye-opener when I first started working on it. What was amazing about it was how unsophisticated it was. There were three or four performance areas, and then basically the studio walls.
The way they used to film it used to make it look like it was a huge studio and massive audience and everything, but it wasn't.
I thought the studio was much bigger, and I was surprised to find that there were only about 100 teenagers who were shepherded from one set to another. So one minute they'd be watching David Essex over here, then the next minute the floor manager would guide them across and they would be watching Rod Stewart over there.
But the reason for that was it was actually quite dangerous on the studio floor because you had the cameras, which were huge in those days.
You had motorised cameras and they could move very quickly. And they're moving in and out of a huge crowd of kids dancing.
The audience was sort of like cannon fodder, really. It was like, get out of the way, there's camera one coming through. So they're all sort of slightly nervous about whether they're going to get mown down by a camera.
So you needed a team of minders who would create a gap for the camera to move in and out.
So keeping the show moving quickly was vital, and that's where the presenters came in.
Between each act appearing on Top of the Pops, it was about 10, 12 seconds. That was to enable me to move cameras from one set to the other, and it was during that time that the presenters did a bit of waffling.
Just yet, we've got a brand new number one for you, and right now we've got a fabulous disco sound from the JALN band.
The links were left completely to you, so it was all your own words. You sort of made it up as you went along, and that was part of the fun, really.
There's no talk back in your ear, there's nobody saying anything, you've got no auto cue. Stand by, Tony. 5, 4. Q.
Here's a lady whose voice is so brilliant, it makes the hairs on the back of your neck stand up.
And that's it. It is like trying to land a plane at, say, Heathrow with no air traffic control. the lights, that's it, get on with it.
OK, so it was technically challenging, but for such a prestigious presenting gig, they were lining up to host the show from day one. Weren't they?
Originally, Johnny Stewart, who was the producer, the original producer, he wanted me to do all of them. I said, no, I don't want to do all of them. I said, I don't want to do it, be on every week. I said, I'll do it once a month. And that's how it started. I didn't want to be too associated with presenting a pop music programme.
One of the things about Top of the Pops was it was a very cheap show to produce. After the recording, I used to do a disco in a pub and I got paid about four times more for working to about 200 people than I did for doing a television show watched by over 10 million.
It's always nice to welcome a newcomer to the Top 30, especially when it's somebody who has written the song that they sing.
You picked your own things to wear. I look back at the fashions now and I think they looked awful.
Everyone thinks you get this wardrobe budget, you get a stylist, nothing. Everything I ever wore on TOTP, I had to buy.
Well done to Simply Red, who are best band of the Brits. They'll be causing a roadblock when they play Wembley Stadium in July.
My sense of style was pretty poor. I mean, it's almost like if you imagine somebody having a super glue stuck to them, blindfolding them and getting them to walk backwards through Topshop.
And it wasn't just the presenters who felt underdressed and underappreciated. It was the dancers too.
We were given a contract to be on the show every single week. But because we were dancers, the BBC would not recognise that we were a group. So every contract we ever had, we were signed up individually as Dancer Dee Dee on Top of the Pops. So, of course, the only thing you ever got was the minimum wage. Even as we became mega stars.
Sounds like behind the showbiz glitz and glamour, Top of the Pops was actually a bit cheap and often in need of a makeover. So it's no wonder someone's left that tin of paint on the set. Whoops, I bet Phil Collins was furious. I can feel it coming in the air tonight. All I want. That's what viewers might have thought when they tuned into Phil's first ever solo performance on the Pops in 1981. But what was the truth?
Phil grabbed me and said, have you got a paint tin? And a paintbrush? And I thought it was an odd thing for some, you know, to ask. And so I said, what colour? And he said, it doesn't matter what colour. Have you got a paint tin? So I went and I just picked up this paint kettle and a brush. And I brought it out of the studio and I gave it to Phil. After Phil came off, I said, I got it in the neck from the producer. And he said, why? I said, because you put this paint tin on the set. I said, what's that about? And he told me it was a little dig at his ex-wife who'd run off with the decorator.
Oh, typical Phil, always sending messages by fax, by song, by paint tin. Although this message was rebutted by his ex-wife, who said Phil had cheated on her. Anyway, that's enough about a paint tin. What about the most infamous blunder in the show's history? As Dexy's Midnight Runners gave this spirited performance, it featured a bizarre cameo appearance that's gone down in TV legend.
I was in the studio for the famous Jackie Wilson incident. With Dexy's Midnight Runners, and to the left of them was a large Idafall screen with a picture on it, not of Jackie Wilson, but of Jockey Wilson, the darts player.
And for those who don't know, this is soul-singing legend Jackie Wilson, and this is Scottish darts player Jockey Wilson. So, easy mistake to make. But was it actually a mistake? We can now reveal the shocking truth.
And it turned out it was Kevin Rowland of Dexy's Midnight Runners who said, can we have a picture of Jockey Wilson? And, you know, the production team and the camera crew all went, that'd be funny, wouldn't it? And they did it and went along with it. It was Kevin Rowland's own idea.
Coming up, Top of the Pops battles on into a new millennium.
I think people knew that the writing was on the wall then for Top of the Pops.
And the show is hit by its ultimate scandal.
Of course, there was one Top of the Pops scandal, but that's something that we don't talk about.
It's 2003. The music industry's changing as CD sales plummet. Music fans are buying songs digitally on the newly launched iTunes, and others are illegally downloading them for free. Meanwhile, in a bid to win back the viewers who have been deserting it for years, an embattled Top of the Pops is putting all its efforts into a huge relaunch. And one man has been put in charge to make it happen, former CBBC broom cupboard presenter Andy Peters.
Andy Peters from Kids TV, who arrived with a load of ideas. Not all of them that terribly good, I think, in retrospect, you know?
The all-new Top of the Pops had flashy new titles, a new presenter and a new format with news and interviews.
The coin. I wanted to play both of your videos, but we can't. Time constraints and stuff.
Oh, charming. The new show was slammed by viewers with complaints of too much chatting and not enough music.
It tried quite hard. It tried to do big performances. It had, like, a little news item as well, but do we really want music news on Friday night? And I think, for me, was it really worth the effort?
The big relaunch was the BBC's secret weapon to revitalise the ageing format, which had seen viewing figures rapidly fall since the 90s.
We were living in a totally different world to what we were technology-wise. Now, with the internet, 24-hour on-demand video, satellite channels and everything, Top of the Pops kind of lost its way.
But while viewers were switching off in droves, a secret enemy had also been at work, the TV schedulers.
One of the arts of TV scheduling, in fact, one of the darker arts, is to prove that it's unwanted by putting it in the wrong place.
I mean, Top of the Pops, since it launched, had always been on Thursday night. The BBC moved it to Friday, thinking it might make maybe just a weekend kind of show. But the move to it is up against Coronation Street, which is obviously this absolute Goliath of viewing figures, and it didn't do well.
You can imagine the conversations of the BBC, you know, the weekend starts here. But actually, the essential target audience was in the pub or out at parties by that time.
The show was later relegated to Sundays on BBC Two, where it didn't fare any better.
Top of the Pops moved to Sunday night. And the thinking was, Sunday's quite a quiet day, maybe a lot of kids might like to watch it then. But it was up against Emmerdale Farm. So it had the same problem as before, being against the soap.
Well, that move proved to be the final nail in the coffin, as viewing figures more than halved.
I think people knew that the writing was on the wall then for Top of the Pops.
I talked to Andy Peters years later about this, and I said, after you left it, did you still watch it on Sunday nights? And he said, no, it wasn't a very convenient time for me.
In a move that surprised absolutely nobody, in 2006, the BBC announced that the show would be axed, citing diminishing audiences and the changing musical landscape.
It cost more money than it was worth in the end. I didn't get the viewers in the end. And so Top of the Pops, in a way, became completely Neanderthal.
So on the 30th of July 2006, Top of the Pops bowed out in style with a farewell show featuring former presenters from the last 42 years. And this enormous musical institution was consigned to history.
I remember the very last show when all the Radio 1 DJs were there, as many people that had presented it. It was emotional.
But that final episode would come to have a darker significance.
Of course, there was one Top of the Pops scandal, but that's something that we don't talk about. Who actually kind of tarnished it for everybody, really, which is a shame.
In 2012, shocking revelations came to light about former Top of the Pops presenter Jimmy Savile and his actions behind the scenes. The man given the honour of drawing the curtain on the final episode of Top of the Pops would ultimately leave behind a much more abhorrent legacy.
I remember the very last shot was him turning the studio lights off.
It's clearly very difficult in a programme of this kind, but it is part of the story. And of all of them, of all the offenders in TV, it's the hardest one to separate the perpetrator from the programme.
Since the fall of Jimmy Savile, it has made this very, very difficult because the spill-off from that was so great. So many people were tainted by the stories that emerged once the dam had burst.
Repeats of Top of the Pops had already started airing on BBC Four, but when the scandal broke, years' worth of episodes featuring Jimmy Savile and other disgraced stars began to be pulled, leaving conspicuous gaps in the show's archives.
Of course, with the events of Jimmy Savile and Operation U-Tree, a huge amount of material that does exist can't be shown, or it would be inappropriate to be shown these days.
Not only are some presenters and performers no longer shown, but as a consequence, neither are the many artists who performed alongside them.
And the BBC is now in this very difficult position of wanting to use its archive footage, but having to trim out anything that might be offensive. And that means if you have Jimmy Savile introducing Gary Glitter on Top of the Pops, this is not something that people feel is appropriate for screening anymore.
I think it's important to remember that Top of the Pops wasn't about who presented it. It was about the music. And that's, I think, really how it should be remembered.
While there's plenty that can't be shown, what can be shown is still massively popular. The repeats on BBC Four are still running and are still attracting hundreds of thousands of viewers.
I think the repeats are brilliant. I think, obviously, it brings Top of the Pops to an audience that wasn't perhaps even around at the time when the original transmissions went out.
One of the fascinating things about the repeats of my era of Top of the Pops in terms of social media, it's been incredible on Twitter. Within 3 to 4 minutes, guaranteed, this is every week, it will be the number one trending subject, regardless of whatever else is going on.
I know so many people who weren't even born in the Top of the Pops days, in the glory days of Top of the Pops, but who love watching Top of the Pops too.
For more than four decades, Top of the Pops was a magical manic mess that splashed some showbiz into all our living rooms.
Appearing on Top of the Pops was a huge thrill. It was absolutely magical.
We were too excited watching our favourite bands to notice the mishaps and chaos that came with it.
I'm very glad I can look back and say, yeah, I was one of the hosts of Top of the Pops.
And we raise a glass to it. Although if anyone puts anything in David Hamilton's drink again, there's going to be trouble.
He's the TV presenter who brought Mr. Blobby to our screens. Noel Edmonds, The Rise and Fall of Mr. Saturday Night, is brand new next Saturday at 9. And tonight, from the Rolling Stones to Donna Summer, we're counting down Britain's favourite 70s hits next.